When you're doing traditional research, you come up with a problem, you find some papers, then you read those papers, you identify papers that are cited in those papers, and then you go and find those and you do that. It's called snowballing. And this is a way of you getting an overview of all the papers that are there. And what you do is you go through, you read it, you're looking for key bits of information, you're looking for where there is consensus in a particular area and where there is disagreement within the area. And then you're balancing those up to be able to draw them together to make a judgment and create a review of the literature. I can tell you, having done a PhD, this activity probably took me, I don't know, 6 months, 8 months, 10 months of the PhD. And even then, even when I had a cupboard full, and literally a cupboard full of papers, I printed them out. I couldn't read them all online. They were long and difficult, and I found it hard reading online. So I printed them all out. So even after I'd done that and sat down and marked them all up, I think that I still then continued doing it. Well, this is a tool. It's called Consensus, and it is a way of really shortcutting that activity. And if I'd have had it when I'd done my PhD, well, I reckon I could have saved 6 months and probably used that time to do even more activity around my experiment, etc. Okay, let's have a look at it. So you go to consensus.app. It looks just like a chatbot. So you've got to ask the question here, and you have different choices. You can do quick, fast research, skimming, summary of 10 papers. You can do the pro, which is 20 papers. And then you've got this deep, comprehensive search that will take you up to 50 papers. But don't worry, you don't need to be doing deep every time. You can do little bite sizes of the pro or the quick to get you where you want to go. You've got some filters over here. So this is really helpful. So you can look at the years that you want. So you can look at papers that were produced at any time during history, or you can go past 2 years, past 5 years. And certainly for undergraduate learning, often they're looking for you to cite papers from the last 2 to 5 years. So this is useful just to narrow that down. You can look at the journal ranking. So academia loves a ranking, and they're always ranking each other as institutions, but they also rank their journals. And so you can go for quarter one journals, quarter two, quarter three, quarter four. So you, or any quarter one to quarter four. So you can select which ones you want, quarter one, quarter two, quarter three. I'm going to leave it as all of them, because I'm not that bothered about where they get the rankings from. But certainly if you were doing a really detailed sort of final piece of work and you were looking for academic papers from the top ranked journals, then you might just select Q1 or Q2 there. Then you look at citations, and you can put how many citations it's had. So that will make sure that that paper has been cited by other people, and so gives you a sense of the importance of that particular paper. Obviously, what it does do is take out things that are very new and that might only have a couple of citations. The whole academic process takes a long time. Getting a paper published, getting citations, it doesn't come quickly. But you can say, you know, I want something with at least 10 citations, for instance. And that will mean that you're getting papers that have been cited in other people's work regularly. So you can tighten down the filters for the papers that you get. You can exclude preprints, so those really early papers. You can, this is a ask for a paper, and you can only, and you can, if you want, just go for open access papers. So those papers that don't sit behind any sort of paywall, you can leave that off. You can have a look at methodology here. So you can do a meta-analysis, a systemic review, and it tells you what all of these things mean, an RCT, so a randomized controlled trial. You can look at non-RCT, observational studies, literature reviews, case reports, animal studies, in vitro studies, so those that have used sort of human or animal testing. You can look at a sample size of at least, and you, so if you choose one of these methodologies, you can look at sample size at least 10 or whatever you want, and duration, control studies, human studies. So if you're in the medical field, for instance, then you might want to put some of these areas in. You can look at different fields of studies. So if you want to just tie it down to business or chemistry or computer science, you can tie your search down. I'm not going to do that because I guess most of my things will come from business, but I actually am interested in what you might find from other disciplines. So I'm going to leave that as it is. So law might come into mine as well. And then you can decide which countries you want, and basically all countries, or you could just search Andorran papers, for instance, or British papers if you wanted. Sure why you'd want to do that. All knowledge is knowledge. There we go. That is the filters. And then basically you just put in a question. So I've just put in a quite a basic question here. What do we know about the link between IPRs and FDI? Press go and it will start. It's thinking relatively quick. So this is the kind of thing that I did for my PhD. So first of all, what do we know about IPRs? What do we know about FDI? What do we know about the link between them? Those sorts of things. And this formed the basis of my PhD. So relationship between IPRs and FDIs is widely studied, but findings reveal a nuanced and context-dependent connection. Stronger IPRs can attract FDI, but the effect varies by country, industry, enforcement quality, and other institutional factors. So it gives you a nice overview, so a quick punchy overview so that you know what you're looking at. So you have high income, innovative nations, stronger IPRs attract more FDI, which is generally what people think. And then you can go here to the actual document by Haiyang Zhang et al. And you see the abstract. And if you want to see the PDF, you can click on that. It says could not reach the PDF. That probably means it sits behind a paywall. But if you click down here where it says PDF, what it will do, it will take you through your college's university library system. So you link them up and then it will take you through to the actual paper. So there you are. There's the actual paper if you want to see it. And then if you want, you can, there you go. There's the details of the paper within Consensus. You can save the paper. You can cite the paper, see what it gives me. So you can choose your citation. So APA, you want to get that. So you can just copy that text, but you can also add it to BibTeX as well, or you can just download it or export it to RIS. You share the paper, and then obviously you can see the full PDF, which you've seen. It gives you, this is really cool, it gives you the key claims and evidence. So stronger IPRs generally attract more FDI, and the strength of that evidence is moderate, supported in many contexts, but not universal, depends on enforcement and sector. And here's some papers that relate to that. Enforcement quality is crucial for FDI impact. So if the laws can be really good, but if they're not enforced, they don't work. Actually, if they do work, then that has a positive impact on FDI, and there is strong evidence for that. IPRs have little effect in some developing countries, and that's because the developing country A doesn't necessarily have much IP itself or the ability to copy and reproduce IPR. So the fact that the rules are a bit loose probably doesn't affect FDI in quite the same way. And it gives you the link between IPRs and FDI is significant but highly context dependent. Strong IPRs and effective enforcement can attract FDI. So it gives you a sort of summary of it. You can create a literature review. And this is now going into depth about the link between the two. So it's looked at, it's 48, it's found, screened 48 papers, and it's found 48 eligible. See what it includes. This took me 6 months. Now, it's not perfect. Of course it isn't. But it gets you going. It gets you started. And of course, what you want to do is go and read these papers. You want to make sure that the papers make sense, that they add up. But you've now got time to do that because you're not spending all your time searching, noting, making notes, finding issues, trying to add them together, trying to work out where the consensus is, where the gaps in knowledge are. You can use this tool to find all of those and then spend all that valuable time reading, learning, understanding, challenging, all of those things that are really useful for your research activity. Look, it's identified 788 papers reviewed. It's just not possible. I don't think you could do 900 papers. Ranking the papers, screened 509, it's found 336 are eligible and it's used 50. There we go. And it's now writing a literature review based on that. We'll come back when it's done and have a look at it. Okay, it's done. And it went through 9 steps. So this used that deep research piece and it found 50 sources. So the link between IPRs and FDI, structured literature review. So you get a nice introduction and you've got all of these different documents here that you can click through to. You've got this consensus level. So IPRs and FDI link, yes. Possible, mixed, and no. And really interesting. So as you can see, there's not consensus, which is great. That's what you want when you're doing some academic research. You want some gaps. You want some things to think about. You want some things to challenge. If everyone agrees, not a lot of research to be done. Went through the methods. It conducted the search of 170 million research papers that sit in consensus, including sources from Semantic Scholar, PubMed, and other major databases. It identified 1,026 papers, 509 were screened, 336 were deemed eligible, and the top 50 most relevant papers were included. So it made choices about what the most relevant were, and it, there you go, it gives you a nice little table about its methodology. Beautiful. And it even puts a proper figure on. 8 unique search groups were used, focusing on theoretical frameworks, empirical evidence, regional industry variation, enforcement, quality and mechanisms linking IPRs to FDI. Gives you the results here. Key papers, picked out the top sort of 5 key papers, key contributors, and then a discussion. And again, demonstrates that the link between IPRs and FDI is complex and context dependent. Then it gives you the claims and evidence of the various papers. Enforcement quality is crucial for FDI impact. Here we go. IPRs have little or no effect on some high-income and weak enforcement countries. That would be interesting to look at. And then a conclusion, and then it gives you where the research gaps are. Research gaps matrix, it sort of gives you a score to say where the gaps are in the learning, and then it leaves some open research questions. So if you were thinking of doing your PhD in this area, how does IPR enforcement quality as opposed to law strength affect FDI in different sectors? You could focus your PhD, for instance, on IPR enforcement quality as opposed to law strength in the high tech sector at works. And you could do your PhD around that sort of thing. Gives you 4 of those. And then it gives you all of your papers. And as you can see, it gives you, it tells you those that are highly cited. I recognize a lot of these. It's lovely. When it's quite a while ago since I did my search. But I recognize these papers. Schneider. Here's a good one. Let's have a look at this one. Oh. There we go. So it goes to economic surveys. Through Coventry University. It's a little bit. There we go. So you can find the paper. Oh. And 14 citations, only done 1 paper. This is definitely behind a paywall, so you're having to use the link that my university gives us. So you get all of your papers, your references there. Fantastic. Really, really good. And you can save these papers. You can share them. Really useful. There we go. Putting together the bare bones, the start of your literature review, using this to gather information that we understand about a particular subject very quickly and effectively, making sure it all comes from academically peer-reviewed papers that you get an understanding of where the balance of thought is around a particular subject. Really, really useful. Let's just have a look at the different settings you've got. You can toggle the theme, you can have it dark mode, etc. You can go incognito so it doesn't know it's you that's doing the searching. And if you go into settings, here you can set your university and put your link in so that the paper, when you're looking for papers, you go through your university system to get the particular paper. Subscriptions, and you can have subscriptions for your team as well. Now, you can use this for free. So go and have a look, have a play with Consensus. If you want to use this regularly, you might want to pay for a plan. You can also get a plan for your sort of team or institution, but Consensus is really worth having. So a simple tool that does what you want. It does that academic paper research. It looks at a massive amount of papers. It gives you a sense of where the consensus is around a particular issue. Really, really good. Simple, effective, cheap to use. Well worth having a look at. Have a go. I think it's pretty good. If you've learned something, if you found something valuable today, then please drop me a like and don't forget to subscribe to the channel. About 80% of you who watch these videos are not subscribed. So maybe 90%. So a subscribe would really help me to help build the channel. And as I say, if you've learned something, let me know. Tell me what you think about Consensus. I mean, I used Google Scholar a lot when I was doing my PhD. I wouldn't use it now. I would use Consensus to find my papers. It's just faster, quicker. You get more information and it will start synthesizing that information right from word go. Okay. I've been the professor. I'll see you soon. Bye-bye for now.